Hi everyone, my name is Jeff Starr and this is my channel Not Bad Films. I make videos about music. Today I want to talk to you about the Fender 68 Deluxe Reverb Amplifier, my experience with it, and why I ultimately decided to return it. At first I filmed this as a series of vlogs, but I figured it was probably better if I just edited it into one sort of succinct video, so that's what this is. My feeling is that this amplifier suffers from some serious design flaws, so if you're looking to purchase it, I would highly suggest watching this video to make sure that this is the right amplifier for you and what your expectations are. It may be exactly what you want, but for me, it was not. I had just too many problems with it, and I couldn't justify keeping it. I had two of these amps for approximately 3 weeks, and the problems were consistent across both amplifiers. I did extensive troubleshooting and used a multitude of guitars and made sure that these problems were not the result of user error. Number one, the overall noise floor of this amplifier is quite high. I've played tube amps for 20 plus years. That's everything from vintage deluxe reverbs to high wattage Marshalls and pretty much everything that's standard in between. I have a lot of experience with other Fender amps, like the Hot Rod Deluxe, the DeVille, Twin Reverb, the Blues Deluxe Reissue. So it's not like I'm coming from outside the Fender world of amps. That's the tone I'm very familiar with. I'm very familiar with the build quality on those amps, and I've played them quite extensively for a long time. The 68 Deluxe Reverb has the highest signal-to-noise ratio of any amp I've ever played. Let's take a listen. For audio on this, I'm just going to use the little shotgun mic that's on top of the camera, and I'm doing that for a reason because I want you to hear sort of the room sound. And the concern that I have with this amp is just how noisy it is. It's just floor noise. Sound three. This is off. Sound six, five. This noise level may be okay in a live environment, but if you're turning the amp up to 10, it does get pretty noticeable, and you may find that in between songs in your set list, there's a lot of hiss. But with a full band, I don't think people would probably notice. If you're looking to get clean tones out of this amp, so you're looking to play it around somewhere around 5, I think that the hiss of this amp is going to be pretty distracting. If you're playing solo, whether that's a coffee house, or maybe it's a wedding reception, or just at home, or even possibly with recording, I think that you're going to find that this level of hiss that this amp has, just its overall noise floor, is going to be problematic. And it's just, I think it's kind of unacceptable just how noisy it is. Now, I'm aware that this amp has reduced negative feedback to give it more touch sensitivity. And as a result, there's less filtering going on, and that does increase the level of noise. I think that this trade-off is, for me, it's not working. But we'll talk more about where I think this amp does excel. One of the main selling points of the 68 Custom Deluxe Reverb is its custom channel, which is supposed to be a unique sort of Bassman tone stack. You may want to plug into both channels and maybe toggle between them using an ABY switch box separately. It doesn't come with the amp, obviously. Or that you might actually bridge the channels and run both channels at the same time, which is something you can't do with a normal deluxe reverb. My experience is that because both channels are so noisy, as you're running both, if you're trying to bridge them, that noise floor is just getting that much more prevalent, and it's just more pronounced. Custom channel's off, but let's say I want to have it on, so I was looking to toggle between them. You can hear. I found that was, well, it was sort of becoming a bit of a deal breaker for me. Because I personally am going to be using that amp recording at home, playing solo. I'm not in a band currently, so I'm looking to have an amp that I would be just myself, a guitar and an amp. So that was going to be something I wasn't really wanting to settle on. Of course, also when you begin to sort of dial in your tone and you want to add more treble or more bass, every time you're turning those knobs up, you're adding more gain into the signal. And you'll see that the level of hiss of the amp is just going up as well. You know, there's a noise floor when everything is at 1, which I think is still pretty loud compared to other amps. And then as you're turning up the volume and you're turning up your tone controls on the amp,
that is just becoming more and more noticeable. Number two, the tremolo circuit on this amp exhibits a really loud and distracting ticking noise. Let's take a listen.
Turn the reverb off.
This is really noticeable if the amp is at a volume of 5 or below. So if you're trying to get clean sounds out of this amp, you're going to really notice this. I've had two of these amps.
So I reached out to Sweetwater, which is where I had purchased the amp. They listened to the amp over the phone. They sent me out a replacement. Okay, we are about 3.5 feet from the amps right now. I'm going to turn on the old amp. Settings are on the custom channel are all at 1. Volume is at 4. Treble's 5. Bass is 5. Reverb is 1. Speed is 6. And intensity is 8. So let's hear what happens. See if that... This is the old amp, so you should hear the ticking. Take it out of standby. So this is the original amp. Okay, so I'm at the new amp. You're still hearing it through the room mic. Let's listen for that ticking. So I'm sure you can hear how they both are exhibiting that ticking. It does seem quieter in this, which is good.
They both exhibited the same problem. If you are turning the amp up loud, if it's on 8 or higher, the ticking seems to go away. So basically this means if you want to get any sort of clean tone or clean tone on the edge of breakup, and you want to use the tremolo, which of course, that's one of the reasons you would buy this amp, because it has a built-in tremolo circuit.
Let's turn that vibrato on again.
That ticking, I think, is really distracting. And for me, that was the deal breaker. I'm looking to have an amp that I was going to be running clean, sort of slightly breaking up. That ticking was just really distracting, especially because in my use case, I'm not playing with another band where that's going to be masked. It did not seem to show up as significant in a recording situation because, you know, the amp is sort of playing loud into a mic, and so relatively it's not as noticeable. But in the room, it was really bothersome. And for me, I want to be able to sit and play guitar and hear the sound coming out of the amplifier and be sort of inspired by that and be really happy with that. And this was just something that for me, I couldn't deal with. This ticking in the tremolo was something I had seen documented in forum posts on the internet, but most of those seemed to be around from when this amp was first released. My hope was that this problem had sort of resolved itself. Maybe Fender had done something with their QC problem, because I wasn't seeing any new sort of complaints about this, but in my experience, it's still there. That problem still exists. The two amps that I had were manufactured in September and October of 2020. So they were pretty new production models. It's only January of 2021 now. Number three, an attenuator can solve a lot of these problems. I was using the Tone King Iron Man 2 Mini attenuator. It's an attenuator that goes up to 30 watts. The Deluxe Reverb is only 22. It's a really great product in and of itself, and I'll do a separate video about that. It really is a game changer in terms of what you can get out of your amp. Even a slight reduction in the attenuator, just taking a few dB off, does lower the noise, because that's being attenuated as well. And that so that ratio of noise to signal seems to be less present as a result. And the ticking becomes less noticeable as well.
Okay, so I have this Ibanez semi-hollow, sort of a 335 style. I'm gonna keep it on the bridge pickup. This is volume on 4. There's no attenuation currently. It's like in the room I still hear that ticking, but I don't know how well this mic picks it up, and I don't really think this mic's gonna pick it up much at all either. I'm now gonna turn on attenuation. You can hear it immediately gets a lot quieter. I'll turn down a click. It's pretty quiet. I think, like, at this point, that ticking is very slightly there, but it's not really, I don't think, a thing that someone would notice. I mean, I notice it. You know, if you're looking to turn the amp up more, let's turn the amp up to 8. Obviously, your noise floor goes up because you have more gain. But the ticking is not really there. And now the in the room volume is really loud, so I'm gonna have to attenuate a little more to maintain that same level of volume. So now I'm at negative 18. I'm at negative 18 now. Now, of course, I've lost headroom, right? It's a lot more gain. So I'd have to roll back my guitar volume to bring back some of that clean headroom. Sorry, that's a dirty pot on my guitar, that crackling. It's just the guitar pot crackling. The amp has a lot more grit regardless. And depending on how your guitar is wired, you may be losing additional high end, so you might want more treble. And if you want to go to 10, I mean, I'm sitting here, so it's not that loud in the room. I mean, it's loud, but it's not uncomfortable for sure. So we're another click lower. So certainly at that volume, unattenuated, like I said, was around 110, 111 decibels on my Apple Watch. clearly it's pretty quiet in here now, right? I'm able to sit right here. Great for recording, and of course the ticking and the noise floor is lower as a result because it's been attenuated. But if you want to get back to having that just clean sound, that like real clean, no matter how hard you hit it clean, like that full headroom clean, I turn the attenuation off. Tickety tock tock. So I don't know.
As the amp gets really above six, that ticking seems to get less noticeable just already. So with the attenuator to bring your overall volume down, that sort of helps to resolve that. But it doesn't resolve it when you're trying to play clean, because as a non-master volume amp, if you want to have those clean tones, so let's say that's five on that amp, you're not going to want to attenuate the amp too much because your volume is already not at its max. You might take a few dB off and that could get rid of some of your hiss or get rid of that ticking, make it not as noticeable. And if I was live, I wouldn't want to be dropping my volume those few dB because I'd probably need that volume to be heard in the live space that I was playing in. Additionally, in a good quality attenuator like the Tone King, the Iron Man 2 Mini is adding $395 to your purchase price. Right, so let's say that's $400. So you're looking at maybe now the cost of the amp with the attenuator is $1,500. And if you're looking to spend $1,500, you could be looking at some other amps that might have other features, maybe even some boutique brands. Just your options of what you're looking at changes because you've increased your budget by essentially $400. You may not be able to increase your budget by that extra $400. You have to ask yourself, how loud can you play this amp realistically? Depending on your situations, whether they're at home or recording or live. And then in addition to that, are you looking to have that overdriven tone or are you looking to have more of a clean tone? So that's why an attenuator can sort of solve some of these problems, but it doesn't really solve them. Now, I have seen online there are other discussions about how to solve some of this, potentially flipping the reverb pan around. Apparently there's an older service bulletin to redress some of the soldering leads inside of the amp that can help to reduce the ticking and perhaps extending some of the wires to move them away from other components. Great, sure, but if I'm looking to buy an amp brand new, I don't want to have to then pay to send it elsewhere to have it serviced. I would like it to just work, right? And I would understand if there was a bad tube, because that happens. But I think that for the cost that Fender is selling that amplifier for, and because this is a fairly well-documented problem from several years ago, I'm sort of surprised that it still exists and it has not been resolved in their QC. That's a bit of a bummer to me. I think that this is something that people really do need to be aware of if you're looking to purchase this amp. If you're not using Tremolo, it's probably not that's not going to be an issue for you. For me, that's part of the sound of why I want a deluxe reverb. If you're looking to only play it cranked, then maybe this isn't a problem. You do need to take note, though, that as you turn up the amp, especially if you're bridging the two channels for even more gain, the noise floor is just going up. It's basically doubling as you bring in the other channel. If you want to start stacking some pedals into that, or you're using a large pedal board that is also just introducing noise into your signal chain, noise is going to be a problem you're dealing with. Number four. There are some things that I really do like about this amp. The spring reverb sounds great. To me, One of the sounds I wanted in purchasing a new amplifier is I wanted a real tube-driven spring reverb. There's nothing like the sound of a tube-driven spring reverb that's turned up maybe a little bit too much, so it's driving the way it sort of rings. I've yet to see or hear a pedal that can emulate this in any sort of realistic way. That to me is one of the big selling points of this amp, and it sounds great. I really like the spring reverb. The balance of how splashy it gets or its subtle settings, I think it fits really nicely. The spring reverb is just great. When this amp is turned up and you are dealing with those overdriven sounds, this amp does sound great, assuming the noise is something you can deal with. If you have that attenuator to pair with it, it's really usable, and I found that I was playing this amp really overdriven a lot, and it was awesome. But that's not the reason I purchased this amplifier. I wanted this to be clean and into that starting to break up, so that I could play lightly and get clean, and I could hit it hard and it would crunch a little bit. I wanted an amp that would have a good dynamic feel. The reduced negative feedback in the circuit helps to accomplish that. And I think overall the tone is really nice, but the noise that's being introduced into the signal for me was just too much. I couldn't enjoy the sound. I found it distracting, and I found it hard to just sort of feel happy with my purchase. I felt like if I was letting that go and I was letting the ticking go, I was very much settling on a product and I wasn't going to be excited about it. And I don't want to play into an amplifier that doesn't make me feel excited or makes me feel disappointed, because I want to play my guitar more and feel good. I don't want to feel like, oh, I kind of wish it was better, you know? So I think that you need to think about what your expectations are in this amp and whether or not those are going to be problems for you. With the attenuator, running the amp at 8 or 10 and really hot, it sounds great. You can use that at home a lot, you know, now. And even at live gigs where you can't get it that loud, or maybe at a rehearsal, it just opens up a lot more options for you. And the Tone King is a really great product, so I definitely recommend that. Without it, though, you have to ask yourself how hot can you really run this amp? Are you going to be comfortable having this amp at, let's say, 3 and putting in an overdrive pedal in front of it? And finally, number 5, the custom channel on this amp is supposed to be a Bassman tone stack. When I was looking to purchase this, I was really excited for this because I thought I'd have 2 sort of tone options. It's really not that different than the vintage channel. It has a little less high end. Maybe it breaks up a little bit earlier, but it's not radically different. It's not having a second amp within this sort of package. It's a feature that sounds great on paper, but in reality, I didn't think it really was that big of a deal, and I didn't find that it was that useful. I would have still just chosen either the custom or the vintage channel and just left it there. I think you're better off just using the high and low inputs, and depending on what type of pickups you have in your guitar, you'll have more change in the tone that way. Hopefully, this was useful if you are looking to purchase this amp. I think that there is still a customer who this is the right amp for. For me, it was not. I think it suffers from just general technical flaws. I'm really disappointed that Fender sort of has a product like this that I think really is documented as this being the ticking and the tremolo being a problem, and it's yet to be resolved after all these years. Sweetwater did send me a second amp to try it out as a replacement, but they both showed the same problems, and I ended up returning both of them. And I rolled that money over into another purchase, and I bought a Dr. Z Z Plus. It's sort of a little hard to compare the two because their price brackets are different. But when you look at maybe adding the attenuator to the 68 custom deluxe reverb, it's not that much more. So it really depends on what your budget is and what you're looking to get out of an amp and what sort of tones you're going for. If you are looking to play this amp cranked you're not using the tremolo and you're playing it in a band, it's probably going to sound really good to you. If you're looking to play it clean or clean on the edge of breakup and you want to use the tremolo and you're playing in either a small duet or a trio or solo or just at home, I think that you're going to be disappointed in the noise level and in the ticking. If you have any questions, please leave a comment. I try to respond to all the comments. If you like this video, please like and subscribe and click on the bell to be notified when I post new content. If you really like this video, I also do have a Patreon page where you can help support me in making more videos like this. A huge thank you to all my patrons. All right, that's it for now. All right, happy practicing. Bye.